Okay, so welcome to the very last lecture of 677. We are going to do a final case study on middleware systems and then just wrap up. There's a little bit of overflow from last time. We want to finish those slides and then move into middleware. So we were talking about distributed security. If you remember last time, we talked about authentication, we talked about encryption, we talked about how you can use these building blocks to do digital signature, secure email, variety of different tasks that you may have to address when you design any distributed system or application. Okay, the very last point of discussion was electronic payment systems. So this slide actually shows how traditional payment mechanisms work. Okay, the first figure here just shows you cash transactions where you basically may withdraw money from the bank, okay, and then you can pay for any goods or services to any payee, and then the payee will then use that money in some way or deposit it to the bank. But the important thing is the transaction between the payee and the payer just involves cash and doesn't require exchange of any personal information necessarily. If you walk into a store and just buy, let's say, a bottle of soda, you just pay for it in cash, there is no record of who you are, unlike other forms of transaction. So cash payments can be anonymous. That's something we'll come back to. Okay. This slide, the figure here shows check-based transactions. Okay, so the bank issues checks to you. You can pay for goods or services by writing a check. Okay, the check basically leaves a paper trail. Okay, so it basically has your account number and there's a record that you paid the payee. The check may also have your personal information printed on it. The payee will cash the check, and then there is a settlement process that runs between the payee's bank and the payer's bank. Okay, the payee's bank will offer the check to the payer's bank saying, here, your account holder has issued this check. Transfer so much money, and then the payer's bank will verify the signature and whatnot, and then this, through the settlement process, money will arrive in the payee's bank. Okay, this is how basically money exchange will happen. So here the actual money gets exchanged between the banks, and now I mean, you just issue a check. Okay. Same kind of process is true when you use credit or debit cards. Okay, so your bank issues a credit or a debit card to you. You basically can pay for goods or services by giving your card, and then there's a card-based transaction process. Okay, that basically again leaves a trail because there's your credit card number, and then it can be tracked, traced back to you. Okay? And then there's a similar settlement process here, okay, where your bank or the payee's bank will basically go to the payer's bank, usually through an intermediary, a payment service like MasterCard or Visa, American Express. So these are intermediaries that allow the settlement process to take place between banks that either accept credit card transactions or issue credit cards. And then essentially the payment is made, and then you may get a bill if it's a credit card at the end of the month. But with a debit card, that money is taken out of your account. Okay? But in either case, these two forms of transactions leave a paper trail. It's not as anonymous as using cash payments. Okay. So people have thought about using electronic cash to give you properties that are similar to using actual cash, okay, whereby you can pay electronically, or the convenience of paying electronically, but have also the advantage of it being anonymous. Just as when you pay cash, there is no paper trail left behind. Okay. Here is the process that sort of level of a principle of how this is done. Typically, if you want to generate an e-cash, either the payer or the payer will generate a coin or a token of a certain denomination, okay, some number or some amount. Okay, and then the coin actually has a serial number associated with it. Okay, so what you will then do is you will blind that coin, which basically means, think of it as you put the coin in an envelope and seal that envelope. So although there is a serial number, that serial number is no longer visible, and you are going to present that to a bank and say, sign it, so that when I present this, somebody can verify that this is actually legitimate money, okay, that this electronic coin is backed by a bank, which is going to say, I will pay you if this person actually presents this So if you blind it, the bank will sign the blinded coin, can hand you back a signed coin. Okay? At that point, you can unblind it. So you can say, here's a coin, it has a serial number, and here is a signature that proves that this is legitimate, it's not some fake currency or something like that. So you unblind, but then you unblind. The bank doesn't actually know which serial number is attached to whom. So this is just in physical cash, although your cash notes have a number so on it, the bank typically doesn't track that it has issued you a $10 note with the serial number. Same is true here. Okay, it is basically guaranteed but not tracked directly or associated with it. So you can make the payment with this electronic cash, and then the payee can just go to the bank and say verify that it has actually been signed by the bank so that you can accept it as a legitimate form of currency. And later on, present it for actual payment. You can say, encash this token, saying, I mean, this was $10, so I actually need $10. Okay? So this is basically an electronic version of cash payments, which were designed to get the advantage of electronic payments, so you don't use physical cash, but you want the same advantage of using real cash. So there's been a lot of work on how there were protocols that were designed on how to do this to ensure anonymity and so on and so forth. Okay. eCash never actually took, although these were designed many, many years. So eCash never really took off until very recently, where if you heard of Bitcoin, Bitcoin is an electronic P2P cash payment process which has similar property. Okay. So this is a virtual currency. It's not associated with any country or any organization. It's a P2P system. Okay, there are servers that are called Bitcoin servers that generate these coins at a certain rate. Okay, so basically 25 coins are generated every 10 minutes. And it's just to ensure that the rate of money supply is controlled, these servers actually have to do some computational intensive algorithm, run that in order to generate a coin. Okay, this prevents, because anyone can start up a Bitcoin server, yes, but it requires quite a bit of computational expense in order to generate this currency. Okay. So basically it has a way to regulate how many coins are generated. It uses digital signatures to allow you to pay to anyone with a public key. You can say that I am actually issuing this coin to this public. But the important thing in Bitcoin is that the value of the currency actually fluctuates. Okay, there is a, just as there's an exchange rate where you may have a different country and that country and another country have an exchange rate that keeps fluctuating. $1 and 1 euro, the rate keeps fluctuating. Similarly, you can think of one unit of Bitcoin has the varying amount of value with respect to $1. Okay, and that depends on the demand, supply, value associated with it, and so on. Okay, so that's the new thing. In eCash, you are actually issuing that electronic cash in a particular currency. You can have eCash for $10. It's like a prepaid card with $10. Okay, in Bitcoin, it is its own currency. So to have you have to have an equivalent value. That value keeps fluctuating. Okay, so there are some interesting aspects of Bitcoin. It is anonymous. As a result, actually, it has seen more use for illegitimate gambling-style users rather than more legitimate users. But there are some merchants that accept it. It's not as widely used, but something I thought you should know, given that they have been in the press for a variety of reasons recently. Okay. So that is electronic payment. The other form of somewhat anonymous payments is using trusted third parties. In this, there is no trusted third party. There's a bank that just signs it or some such thing. PayPal is an example of electronic payments where you don't reveal everything to the party that you're making a payment to. In particular, you don't actually give your credit card information. Okay? That third party actually intermediates for you. And so you say, I want to pay this person X, and in this case, PayPal will ensure that they bill you and then they transfer that money. It's more like a money transfer service, and it is used in cases where you may not trust some random merchant on the internet with your credit card information. It is not as anonymous because clearly PayPal has a track trace of what you did, and if you're buying goods and services, in any case, you might have to reveal your name and information. Otherwise, they can't ship you whatever you bought from them. Okay? So it serves sort of a different need, but it is somewhat more anonymous than using giving a credit card to someone. Not anonymous, somewhat private. Yes.
I think it's important to note that with eCash, I don't think it was just happenstance or wrong place, wrong time that didn't take off. I think there were significant failures on the part of so-called bank entities.
Yes.
Yeah,
so eCash people have tried to make it work for a long time, never actually took hold. I think basically there is the technology aspect and there is the society aspect, right? So if society demands something, the product becomes successful. Even in this case, the technology is there. There is no problem with ensuring all the properties you want, anonymity and sort of ability to transfer money and so on. But it was just a commercial failure, just as there have been many product failures. That's not to say they will not take off. I mean, some currencies like Bitcoin seem to be taking some shape or form, but we'll see. Yes.
How does the Bitcoin guarantee the anonymous? There are some digital signatures.
Yes, so digital signatures are used to pay. So if you say, if the merchant says, give me $10 for the product I want to sell you, you basically ask the merchant, give me your public key and I'm going to send a payment to this public key. Okay, just as in PayPal, you can send money to anyone with an email address. In Bitcoin, you can make payment to anyone with a public key. So it's not that you are revealing your public key. This is what the receiver has to give you, saying, this is my identity. Associate that payment with that identity. Okay, that's basically how it is used. Okay, good point. So anyway, we'll move on to middleware. I'm going to do a quick broad brush introduction to middleware. There are many systems out there that provide you middleware support in some shape or form. If you remember the very first class when I was talking about operating systems design, I said there is a network operating system, there's a distributed operating system, and there's a middleware-based system. Middleware-based systems are software layers that use underlying OS level support, but build higher level functionality that you can use to write useful applications. And I said we'll come back to middleware towards the end of the course. So here's where we are going to review. Okay. There are four systems. We do not have the time to go into each of them in detail. So I'm going to only give you a flavor of what these systems are capable and what they do, just so that you have some idea of what these middleware systems. As you will see, they're fairly complex in what they can do. Okay? All of them are based on object-oriented approaches. So they all use distributed objects. So I'm going to spend a slide or two just talking about distributed objects, and then we will go through them quickly. Okay? So we have looked at RMIs and remote objects when we did communication. So this is just a recap slide. That just shows you what this object is. So the idea is that there is an object that's at the server end. The object has some state, it has some methods. Other objects can invoke methods on those objects. Okay? And typically the way this will be done is through RMI calls. There are stubs at both ends, they're called proxies and skeletons that will take care of the communication, marshalling and demarshalling of arguments and so on. Okay? This is the basic RMI interface that is provided to you. What distributed objects do is they take this RPC or RMI interface and they allow you to pass object references. Object references are network pointers to objects. Typically when you do RPCs, we said that you cannot pass pointers because a pointer is a memory address on the machine. Giving a memory address as a parameter to some other machine is meaningless because if you try to dereference that pointer on that machine, it will point to an address on that machine, not on the previous machine. Okay, so passing traditional memory pointers doesn't make any sense. So in the object-oriented or distributed object world, you have this notion of network pointers. Okay? Think of a network pointer as an IP address of a machine and a memory address on that machine. So it says when you dereference a network pointer, you are basically given a machine name or a machine address and an address on that machine. So now if you dereference it, you're actually dereferencing the right thing on the right machine. So what distributed objects do is they allow you to pass these network pointers from one machine to another. They could be pointers to, in references in this case, to objects, or they could be references to other things. And you can dereference them and call methods on them and so on. Okay. So you take the basic RMI or RPC notion and allow the ability to pass this network pointer. Okay. So just to give a flavor of what a network pointer looks like, this is the what an object reference in the CORBA middleware system. So basically it's a pointer. Think of it as an opaque pointer, but it has various fields. So the thing that we care about is, we'll see that as part of the pointer, you have the host IP address, is a port number, and even tells whoever is dereferencing, this is the port that object is listening on. Okay. And there's an object key that's sort of the pointer on that machine. Okay. So these are the fields we care about. There are many other fields which we will ignore for the moment. Okay. So that's basically a way by which you can pass these references and dereference them on arbitrary machine. And basically it will require you to send, dereferencing requires network messages in this case, not just looking or peeking at a memory address. Okay. Many of the distributed object systems we'll talk about use a similar notion. This is very specific to CORBA, but basically the principles are the same. If you have a reference to an object on a different machine, you better know the address of the machine, the port number that you can use to contact that object, okay, as well as the object ID. Okay. Here's a quick historical overview of how RPCs have evolved to middleware platforms. So that's basically the standard RPC that you have encountered. Okay, there was a system called DCE, Distributed Computing Environment. It was one of the early RPC-based middleware systems. Didn't go very far, was more or less a commercial failure, even though companies like IBM were backing it. Okay, that evolved into DCOM and CORBA. DCOM is the middleware in the Microsoft world. We'll talk a little bit about that. And CORBA was sort of the middleware that was developed in the Unix world. Okay. DCOM, there are of course lots of Microsoft-based Windows applications that are DCOM-based. But CORBA itself, you'll see it was very complex, but did not go very far. And what CORBA has evolved into today is, I mean, because people threw out the unnecessary complex part, retained the essence of it, added that to Java, and basically EJB is as sort of an incarnation of those ideas. It's not the same thing. It's sort of a middleware in the Java world. Okay. And basically where many of them failed was they tried to address this vision where you have these objects, each object is spread across lots of machines. These objects can call each other. It's a very general view of what a distributed computing middleware allows you to do. But what EJBs and others have done is they say this is the common case. Common case is a client-server system. So really you need to only worry about objects at the server and some calls from objects at the client. Okay? Rather than this very complicated picture which required a lot more complexity in the middleware, which often is not used, because most of the applications actually follow client-server model. If you design it with that picture in mind, there's a lot more utility and less baggage that goes with it. Okay, so that's really a quick sort of a history of evolution of this. So we'll talk about several of these, okay, sort of one after another. So we'll start with EJB. That's really the most relevant or the most practical thing. Okay, so EJB stands for Enterprise Java Beans. Okay, this is Java in the enterprise world. Okay, it provides everything that Java does, but it adds a middleware layer, provides number of useful additional services that any application that you see in companies or even on the internet might use. Okay. This picture will show you some of those services. Okay, so you have RMI. This comes out of the box with any Java application or any JVM. But then you have JDBC. Okay, this is the Java database connectivity. So this allows you to write Java applications that can make calls to databases. Okay? And it deals with the platform. It doesn't matter whether the database is Oracle-based or IBM database or MySQL or PostgreSQL. It's a platform-independent layer that just allows you to express SQL queries, and it will do all the necessary things to connect to the database, extract your data, and so on. Okay, so it is basically providing you some platform independence, the ability to talk to databases. In multi-tier application, that's very useful, because the back end of application, as you have often seen, are databases. Okay? the JMS, which is the Java messaging service. So we talked about message queuing and messaging of various sort. JMS allows you to provide this kind of messaging. And there are many other services. This only shows a few of those. Okay, so this is essentially the middleware layer that enterprise version of Java provides you in addition to RMI. And then what you have is applications that are written as objects. Okay? Objects in this world are called beans. Okay, I don't know why, but they are called beans because Java probably has association with coffee and there are coffee beans, so maybe they thought Java beans make sense. Okay, so there's a coffee-based metaphor here, but be that as it may. So those are EJBs or objects. Okay, we'll talk a little bit about what they look like. Okay, so objects basically have interfaces. Those are methods that the object exposes that other objects can access. Okay, so this is standard RMI-based access. Okay, that allows, and you have remote interfaces. So these objects, although this here is what we have is a picture with only one machine. Typically, you can have more than one machine. These objects will be distributed, okay, or replicated. Also, in some cases, typically they are used to write client-server applications. There are a few kinds of objects that you can use in this world. Okay? There are what are called stateless objects. Okay? So these are objects with no state. Okay? There are stateful objects. So these are objects or classes that keep some state. Okay? There are entity objects. So these are also called persistent objects. Okay? So both the stateless and stateful objects, these are objects stored in memory. Entity objects, you do not need to do that. There are objects that persist across applications shutting down and coming back up, which means the state of the object is actually stored on disk. You can recreate an object next time you restart the application. Okay? In most cases, like if you have a Java app, you shut down the application, any objects that you created go away. When you restart it, you start with a clean slate. Okay, if you want the object state to persist across application invocation, you need to have persistent which these applications allow you to do. Okay? So that will automatically keep the state on disk, and when you shut it down, the state is saved to disk. When you restart it, the object can be recreated as if nothing has happened. Okay? So those are called entity beans, and you have messaging. Okay? So these are objects that allow enable message. So different types of objects. When you write your application, you have to think when you define a class or whatever, which of these to pick. And the answer is it will depend on what you're trying to do in the application. Does the application keep state or does that object need to keep state? If not, you use stateless. If you do, you need to do stateful. If you need to have state persist across invocations, like if you have to keep the state on disk, you do entity beans and so on. Okay? So it uses familiar Java-based programming, but it gives you higher level features that allow you to write these applications in a much easier way. So that's basically what J2EE, which is Java 2 Enterprise Editions, essentially does. And they are all based on this notion of enterprise Java. In this class, we didn't have an opportunity to program using J2EE. But if you actually go to any software company, you try to write a Java application, odds are you're not using vanilla Java, you are using the enterprise version. So some of this you will actually encounter in that environment. Okay, so we'll talk a little bit about Korba now, and you'll see that there are some similarities and differences as well. So Korba is another middleware framework. It predated EJBs. EJBs are sort of the most modern incarnation of this middleware platform. Korba was actually 10-20 years old compared to EJBs. What it does is, at the heart of it is what is called an object request broker or an ORB. That's why the name Korba, C stands for Common as Object Request Broker Architecture. It's an acronym. Okay, ORBs are essentially is the core of the middleware platform that enables objects to talk to one another. And there is this notion of a broker that is basically allowing messages to go back and forth and intermediating between objects making requests and so on. Okay. On top of the ORB layer, you have a variety of services that Korba provides you out of the box. Okay? And just to give you a flavor of the different kinds of services, here is a list. It's a partial list or it's a long one. Okay? You will see that depending on what you want to do in your application, there's already a service built in. If you want to use database style transactions, there's a transactional service. If you want to do, if you want to license your software, there's a licensing service. If you want to use threads, there's a concurrency service that will manage a thread pool for you. If you want to do queries, there's a querying service. Okay? You want to save the state of the object on disk, the persistent service. You want all of your communication to be secure, just as we talked about SSL, there's a security service. Okay, so they basically decided to write a middleware that anticipates lots of the common things you encounter in any distributed application and make it a service. So you just write the high-level code, use the right services to do what you need to do, and then the middleware takes care of it for you. Okay. That was the vision. Okay. So it's basically a large middleware platform. If you think about the list of services that you have, okay, you'll see that this is just an incomplete list. You'll see that it's fairly heavyweight. Okay. Now with that, flexibility also comes disadvantage. First is complexity. Okay. If you're trying to write a very simple application, the learning curve to even understand that there are all these services, how to use them, what their APIs are, is a big, big one. Okay, so to become productive takes time. Okay, so if you have something relatively straightforward, you can write something in a simple way. Why do you want to go with something that is very complex? Okay, unless you need all of that power. So it is a lot more complex. And secondly, there is an overhead associated. Any middleware imposes overhead because that's a software layer that sits between the OS and the application. In the Korbas case, that overhead was actually quite high. That meant that applications ran very slowly. Even J2E applications are known for that overhead. Many J2E applications, when you rewrite them the first time, you see that it's much, much slower. And if you just return them in plain Java, because there is much higher overhead of the middleware. In Korbas case, that overhead was substantial. As a result of some of these problems, the middleware actually never really took off. There are some systems that do use them, but it's not as popular. The only system that has actually used them to some success is the GNOME desktop in Linux. That is actually based on a lighter weight version of Korbas. Okay, doesn't use all of Korbas. They re-implemented the pieces they wanted, but they stuck with the Korbas abstraction of orbs and so on. Okay, so if you actually look at GNOME and sometimes look at the messages that it is logging or debug messages, you will see that are references to orb and Korbas and so on. That's about the only place where it has actually been used widely. There were some systems that were built on it, but never quite took off. But for our purposes, I'm going to talk about one service that is of some interest to us, which is the event service. Okay. And because that's one service we haven't seen, so I'm going to spend a little bit of time talking about that. This is the object model for Korbas. It looks like a pretty standard distributed object model. There's a client, there is a server. The stub is represented by the orbs at both ends. And you will see essentially there's an application and there is the same IDL, and you write interfaces, you make RMI calls on the middleware makes RMI call. A pretty standard model. There are some things here which we don't need to worry about, which is the dynamic interface and so on. Korbas allows a lot of additional functionality where objects can be started on the fly. You can import interfaces on the fly. We don't need to go into all of those details here. I want to focus instead on the event service. Yeah. So essentially, there are a class of applications called publish-subscribe application or pub-sub application. It's a class of applications we haven't actually talked a whole lot about here, okay, and I just did want to mention that a little bit. Okay, in publish-subscribe applications, what happens is there are your application is split into publishers and subscribers that exchange data. Okay? Publishers publish data. Subscriber subscribe to data of interest, and this is how message exchange actually happens. Okay, so you can publish an event or a data, and then the middleware will then deliver it to any subscriber that has subscribed to that event. Okay. And what that event is depends on the application. It could be a message that you want to send that's published as an event or a data item, and then the subscribers get. what sits in between publishers and subscribers in Korba is the event channel. Okay? Think of an event channel as a delivery mechanism where, in this case, producers are called suppliers. Suppliers are producing data or events and they are sending it to the event channel. The event channel takes every event and says, who should I deliver this to? Okay? Which components have interest in this event? Okay, and consumers are assumed to have subscribed to certain events. So you can say if there is an alert for CPU on this machine going about, CPU usage going about 90%, tell me. Okay. So then if the event gets published saying high CPU usage, you will say that's an event of interest to this application. Okay. You can basically subscribe to any kind of event and the events are only delivered to whichever consumers have asked for that kind of thing. That's basically the model for writing PubSub apps. Okay, so you'll see that there are many such applications, many distributed applications that use the publish subscribe model. Okay. Korba provides you middleware, okay, the event service in Korba provides a sort of middleware layer support and makes it easy to write this publish subscribe. Well, it takes care of allowing you to publish an event, it takes care of allowing you an interface to subscribe to events of a certain kind and so on. That is done through the event channel. What is shown on this slide is a push-based PubSub application where subscribers, or rather publishers, are pushing events. Okay? And their data, this is a buffer. And the event channel is simply a buffer. And when events arrive here, it matches them against the subscription and those event data is then pushed to consumers. Okay? This is a push-based model. And what you see here on the next slide is a pull-based model. And the event channel here is actually polling the producer, saying, do you have any event frequently? And whenever there is an event or data, the sub producers will provide it and they come to the event channel. And the event channel will buffer it. And then the consumer will poll also, saying, is there any new data? And then you can mix and match. You can do push from the suppliers and pull from here. So this is pure pull. The previous slide showed you pure push. You can also do mix and match. Okay. So this is basically a way of writing applications, and we'll see another example when you look at Genie to see how this actually works in the Genie world as well. Okay. But the thing to take away is, in addition to client-server, peer-to-peer type application architecture, there is also this other kind of architecture called publish-subscribe that you frequently see. It's used in many kinds of messaging framework or where you want to publish certain types of data and then have it get pushed to some subset of application components in the system. This is a very useful way to write this application. So I just showed you how Korba makes it easy. You don't have to use Korba to write publish subscribe. But most pub subsystems now don't even use Korba. They use their own libraries to do the same thing. Any questions on this? Okay, so I had one more slide here, which was just to show you the flexibility of Korba. You will see that just as when we talked about RPCs, Korba will support synchronous RMI communication, supports one-way RMI communication, it supports deferred synchronous. So all of the mechanisms that I was talking about in the abstract are actually were implemented in Korba. So when you say make an RMI call, you have to also specify which type of call or which abstraction do you want to use. Typically, it will be synchronous, which is blocking calls, okay, as the default. Okay, but you can also do one-way calls. You can do asynchronous, deferred, and so on. Okay? So those other abstractions or semantics are also supported in the context of Korba. So here is an example of asynchronous method invocation. The way this works is client makes an RPC request, or RMI request, that goes to the server. Okay. And since it's asynchronous, the client will not block. It will continue execution. Okay. And then eventually a response will come back from the server. Okay. And then what the ORB is going to do, or the middleware is going to do, is do a callback. A callback is like an interrupt that comes to you, saying the response to your previous RMI has come back. Okay, and at that point, you basically jump into a callback service method that says, what should I do with the response? And then you process that response. This is the way you would write asynchronous applications. So typically you will register a callback function. You make a request and then you continue. Eventually the response comes back, and when the response comes back, you basically, that callback is invoked, and then you service the response. Okay, if you have written any GUI based application, you probably know what callbacks are. Okay, typically when you press a button, that triggers a callback, says what should I do when this event has happened. The same kind of method is true here. Okay, so this is callback based asynchronous method invocation. Forma also supports polling based. Okay, so you can basically, so if you do not want the callback interface, what you do is you send a request and then you continue execution. And then basically periodically you will poll, saying has the reply come back. Okay. So if the reply does come back, the OR will actually store it for you, and it's assumed that you will poll at whatever frequency the application cares to. And when the reply, after the reply comes, the next poll will deliver the results to you. So you can either have the system tell you your response has come back, or you can keep polling until the response comes back. So both of those are supported. So as you can see, there is a lot of flexibility, but this also increases complexity. That is really the sticking point for part of the reason why Corba never took off, because programmers have to understand lot more details in order to be productive and write code. There's a big learning curve in understanding how to use some of these abstractions. Okay, so I'm going to talk a little, having talked about Corba, I'll talk a little bit about DCOM. At a very high level, it has similar features, right? But it is a lot more successful because it's sort of the only system you have if you are programming in the Windows world. Okay? There is a long history to DCOM. Okay? It started as COM and then it became OLE, and then it became DCOM, and now it has sort of evolved into .NET. I'm going to talk a little bit about this history. Okay, so this is basically the architectural layer. Okay. At the very bottom, you have what is called COM. I'm going to talk about what that is. Then you have something called OLE layer sitting on it, object linking and embedding. There's an ActiveX layer sitting on that. And then when you do this in a distributed fashion, it becomes DCOM. So just to give a flavor of how all this came about, so in the sort of many years ago, almost 20 years ago, Microsoft Office, it was Office Suite, then Microsoft, and came up with this notion of compound documents. Okay. Compound documents basically allowed you to import data from one type of document into another. So you could take an Excel spreadsheet or Excel chart and import it into PowerPoint. Okay. So if you wanted to show a graph, you first put the data into Excel, you draw an Excel chart, and then you import that chart into PowerPoint. Now you have a compound document where you embedded an Excel spreadsheet into a PowerPoint document. It's no longer a pure presentation. It is a combination of a presentation and a spreadsheet object. Okay. So there was this notion that it was often useful to take figures drawn in PowerPoint and import them into Word. You could, because PowerPoint has a better drawing interface, draw the figure, you import it into Word. Again, a compound document which has a document that you have created and some figures that you have imported from PowerPoint. Okay, that's basically what was referred to as COM. It allowed you to create this compound document. Okay. What that then evolved into is what was called object linking or embedding, which was a more general layer by which you could, they added an object-oriented abstraction to it, and they said this chart or a PowerPoint Excel chart is an object. I'm taking this object and embedding it into another object. That's called object linking, or I'm linking one object to another object with object linking and embedding. And now behind the scenes, you could have PowerPoint making RPC calls to let's say Excel, saying how should I render this spreadsheet. Okay. You didn't actually see this. That's all happening transparently in the back. So they had this layer by which you could embed one object into another, have one application make method calls on another object. So how do you render this? Or when you try to edit within from PowerPoint a chart, it would actually bring up Excel from inside. And that's because PowerPoint could invoke or make calls on Excel and allow you to do this. Okay, so that basically allowed these applications to make RPC calls, not just embed data. Okay, so that was OLE, or object linking and embedding. Okay, Olay eventually became ActiveX, which is a lot of this with the ability to embed this into browsers and so on. Okay, so when there was web servers came along, they figured they'll just use this abstraction and generalize it. It actually was quite a bit of a hodgepodge of things. We were quite clear what all it contained, but it essentially had this notion of object embedding, linking, making calls, and so on. Eventually, that evolved into DCOM, where they said, hey, we need to do this across machines. Because if you have objects, you don't want to just have objects call methods on another object. Objects would call methods on objects residing on other machines. Okay, so now objects became distributed, and they were called that DCOM, distributed component objects. And the latest incarnation of all this is .NET, which adds a flexible runtime, language independence, and so on. But we'll not go into .NET. We'll just sort of stop at DCOM because we are interested in sort of the distributed object abstraction. This is really the figure, which, as you will see, doesn't look very different from any of the object-oriented ones. So there is essentially a stub, which is the COM layer. In CORBA, it was called the ORB layer. So here's the client, here's the server, there's a stub. In fact, it's called a stub. There is an entity that will marshal and demarshal arguments. There are applications sitting at both ends. Okay. So it's very similar to all of the distributed object model. There's one extra thing you will see. There's a disk here, and I think that is called a service control manager and the registry. What this allows you to do is to have objects that will persist on disk. You can keep the code for the object and the state for the object on disk and load it on demand. You don't have to have the object class instantiated, the object corresponding to a class instantiated in memory. You can load that class on demand. Okay, this is so objects can either be transient or persistent. It is also in the CORBA world and the DCOM world. Okay. Persistent objects are referred to monikers. Okay. That's just a term that they use. We don't really need to worry about why. Okay. And basically what this figure shows is all of the steps that have to be performed in order to load a class or an object from disk on demand. So if the client binds to a particular type of an object, then the system will then look up that class ID saying, where does this object reside? Okay, and it'll tell the SCM saying, create an object. Okay, so then what the SCM will do is it will load the code for the object, that's the class. Okay, and then basically it'll create a reference to the object. Then it'll say, if the class was already created, it must have some state. The variables are not all initialized to nulls or zeros. You will actually load all of the data of the state from disk as well. You load the state from disk, and now you recreated the object. The class or the methods have been loaded from disk. The state, previous state, has been loaded from disk. So the object looks like it's what it was previously before you shut it down or put it back to disk. So all of those steps actually have to be performed in order to recreate or create, either create a new object or recreate the state of a persistent object. This is an additional feature that most distributed objects allow you to do. And the reason for this is the assumption is applications are long-lived. You don't want the state to disappear if you shut the application. Typically, what you do is you, the application programmer, writes out whatever state you care about into a file or a database, and you will reload it. Okay? In this case, you can just take that entire class and dump it out. And then the next time you start it, the whole class can be loaded in, so everything looks exactly the way it was. Okay. And all of these middleware interfaces will allow you to do this. There are different kinds of these objects that you can have persist. The most common one is the class moniker, which is really a class with methods in it, but you can have URLs or files. Files are by definition persistent, but they have actually incorporated that into notion of DCOM object types, or moniker types. Okay. Any questions about this notion of a persistent object? Again, that's somewhat different from what you encounter in Java or Python, because anything, any objects you have sort of instantiated go away. Okay, they're only stored in memory. Most of these systems allow you to persist that state on disk, okay, store it and retrieve it transparently. You don't have to do too much. So I'm going to spend a little bit of time talking about the very last middleware platform. It was a very quick introduction. We haven't gone into too much of details. So the details we've already seen in the past. So just to give you some flavor of what these platforms do. This one, the Genie platform, is somewhat different from the other three. Corba, EJBiz, DCOM, they all are object-oriented, but they use standard RPCs and sort of the very standard model. This one is actually going to be different. It is designed mostly for what very loose form of coordination or distributed coordination. Here's sort of a figure that shows different kinds of interactions that can occur, and we'll see where Genie falls. So if you look at two entities, whether they're clients or servers or two peers or two components of an application, how they're interacting, you can classify those interactions based on what is called space and time. Okay. Whether they're coupled in space, the interactions are coupled tightly in space or time or both. Okay. So if you're tightly coupled in space and tightly coupled in time, this is called direct interaction. This is, you are having an active chat with someone else. Both of these entities are present, okay, at the same time, and you are having that communication live. Messages are going back and forth. Okay. This is basically coupled in space and time. Okay. Email is decoupled in time. Okay. When you send an email, you don't expect the recipient to be actually actively present. The delivery of that message takes place at a later time, whenever that person checks their email next. Okay. So it's decoupled in time. That communication is not tightly coupled in time, but spatially it's coupled because there is a well-known sender and a well-known recipient. You know who you are sending your mail to. So you basically name the email address is specified, so you know who that message is going to. Now you can have so that's basically decoupled in time. You can have communication methods which are decoupled in space. Okay. This is called meeting oriented. You call a meeting, you announce the meeting, and whoever is interested shows up. You don't know who is going to show up, who that message is addressed to. Right? Think of a field trip that I arrange, right, as a sort of a crude example. I just said, we have a field trip. Whoever wants to come will come. Okay, when I send that message, I did not send it to a particular party. I just sort of announced it broadly. And some people decided they're interested and they're going to show up. Same thing. If you announce a meeting and then say, come, people, some people will show up and others may not. So you don't know. In this case, it is coupled in space or entire time, but not in space. Because you send the message and people receive it and show up at the time. So basically, there's time associated with the meeting, but you don't know who might come. And the most general or loose form of coordination is decoupled in space and time. You send messages, the delivery of the message takes place at a later time, and when you send that message, you don't even know who the intended recipient is going to be. Okay? There are systems that allow us to do that, and we'll talk about that system here. So you have to ask, what is the purpose of sending a message when you don't know who is going to receive the message or when they are going to receive a message? What kind of scenario do you expect such applications to be useful? When you're communicating with someone, you don't know who you're communicating with. Neither do you know if your messages will actually be interesting to someone. Okay? So we'll look at some examples of why this is useful. Okay, so these kinds of very loose forms of coupling or coordination are often useful in an environment where you need to go discover services on the fly and communicate with those services on the fly. And you're not pre-configured. So the standard example that is sort of worth thinking about is you take your laptop and you show up, let's say, at your friend's home. Okay? And you connect your laptop to their Wi-Fi network. And you just want to print some document. Okay? The old way of doing it is asking your friend, saying, hey, is there a printer? What's the address of the printer and whatnot? And then you configure the printer and you print. Okay? The modern way of doing it is that you basically just say print. Your machine goes out and discovers a printer, okay, and associates with that printer, and you basically just print your document. Okay. So in this case, the printer is announcing, it's sending messages saying, I'm a printer. Okay. It doesn't know whether anyone is interested in hearing that you are a printer or whether anybody cares. Okay? So it is just sending a message saying, or it has published a message saying, I am a printer. If you are interested, talk to me. Okay? And your machine goes out and tries to discover, is there even a printer? And then talk to okay. So that is a very loose form of coordination that you typically don't see, okay, where messages are posted. So there is this whole class of distributed systems where you automatically discover services and associate with them. Many Mac-based systems have these services built in. Okay, if you actually look under Mac and print, you will see nearby printers. If you go into iTunes, you will see nearby iTunes library. It has gone and discovered these things for you. Okay, and so your machines are advertising services. Other machines go and discover those services. You'll see nearby servers. Okay. So there, all of that communication happens very loose, in a loose form of coordination. You are not actively, you don't know who wants to talk to you. You just announce yourself or post some notices and you come back. This is also referred to, this form of communication is also referred to as the bulletin board model. Okay. Let's say you want to, you're moving to a new apartment and you want to sell some of your old stuff. Okay. What you do is you make a note and you put it up on a bulletin board. Okay. So you've just announced an interest to sell something. That note is not addressed to anyone in particular. You just posted a note, okay, saying, I want to sell something. And then some people may come up and look for that note and say, okay, I am interested in buying some of this. And they may actually take your phone number from that. Okay? So you sent a mail, you posted a message. Okay? You don't know who the intended recipient is. And someone else has come at some arbitrary later time and looked for a message saying, is somebody selling some stuff? Maybe I need some new furniture or whatever, or old furniture that I need to buy. And they took delivery of that message. This is the model in which these systems work. There's a shared bulletin board. Anybody that wants to make any announcement posts a message to this bulletin board. Any other party that has any interest in any kind of message goes and searches a bulletin board. Is someone selling furniture? Okay. Is there a printer in this on this Wi-Fi network? Okay. If there's a printer and it has posted a note, you go discover it. Okay. So there's sort of the shared bulletin board in Genie world. It's called a shared tuple space, where you go and post notes. The notes are not addressed to anyone. It's almost like doing a broadcast. You just make a public announcement. Okay? Other services come and try to discover what is available, what is of interest, and then they pick up whatever is of interest to them. Okay? So the communication, as you will see, between the two entities is decoupled in space and is decoupled in time. Okay? By space, I mean it's not addressed to anyone in particular. By time you when you post a message, you don't know if it ever will be delivered to someone, if anybody will ever look for it, or and when they will look for it. Okay. So very useful for loose forms of communication that are based often on auto-discovery, okay, where services announce themselves, other services discover them, and so on. Okay. It's used a lot in system administration for automatic configuration of services, where your machine is smart enough to go and figure out what services are out there and pre-configure them for you, so you, the user, don't have to do much.
Is there any specific service as a bulletin board, or there are just broadcasts going on too?
Yes. So if you use Genie, which Genie is actually a Java-based middleware, they actually provide this bulletin board. Okay. Although I gave the Mac example of discovery, Macs don't actually use a bulletin board to publish. They're simply sending broadcast messages. I am a printer. This message is just going and flooding the network, and all that a machine has to do is sit and listen. It is wasteful in network resources to do broadcast this, but then there is no repository you have to go and publish, post the message. That's the, so if there is a well-known repository which Genie provides, you only post that message once. You don't have to announce every 10 seconds, I'm a printer. You just go and say, I'm an HP printer. This is my IP address. If you're interested, communicate with me and send me a print job. You do this once on the shared bulletin. If you don't have that bulletin board, you're only basically stuck with broadcast messages. Okay, so there are, of course, ways to just use broadcast, but Genie provides this way by you have this notion of a bulletin board that's shown in this dotted line. So here you're seeing like three applications. Okay, application one writes this message A, what the message is not of any importance. It could be I'm a printer, that one would might write I'm a bee. And here is the third application that's trying to read. Okay, it specifies a query. Think of this like as a very simple database where you say, show me all messages that have type printer. So then you'll go and look for all, search through all of these messages, and whenever you find a match, all the matches are returned. Okay, so you basically look for all tuples that match a certain criteria, and then in this case, C is the tuple that matches it. You can take delivery, you can also delete it if you want to, or you can just, if you say you are a printer, you don't delete that message, but you can also use this to communicate and remove messages. Okay. So this is essentially a Java space or a tuple space, which is your shared blackboard. Okay. The reason this is shown in a dotted line is because there is no central entity here where it is shown. This bulletin board itself can be distributed, and it is in the Genie world actually distributed. Logically, it looks like one bulletin board. Physically, it's split into multiple machines. Okay. Each of them might have all the data or some of the data. Depends on how you configure it. Okay, so I already. So this is a scenario where you ask for a callback. So not only do you can you actually publish data, you can also specify saying if some data of this type is published, go ahead and notify me. Okay, so if you say if some printer shows up, send me a message. So that's a callback. So you request a notification for all messages that match a criteria T. That callback is registered. So whenever a matching data item is inserted in the bulletin board, you get a notification saying, I have a message that is of interest to you based on what you told. So you can also specify callbacks. You don't have to keep going. In the previous case, you go and query actively. You don't keep polling the bulletin board. You can also specify anything that's of interest to you, and the tuple space will notify you whenever a message, matching message is actually put in. Okay, so there are a couple of ways to implement, two different ways to implement this. Here is basically a scenario where you can replicate all of the data. Okay, so whenever you post them, so this is a replicated bulletin board where all the data is replicated. Okay, so whenever you write to the bulletin board, writes are broadcast. So that means reads are local, because your cache of the bulletin board on the local machine, on the local server, is basically has a copy of everything. So you just go to your local server and replicate. Okay. So broadcast writes, local reads. Okay. This is a partitioned bulletin board. Okay. So think of this as there's a bulletin board on the first floor, second floor, and third floor. You can go and post a note on your local bulletin board. Okay, so each bulletin board has different data items. So when you do a read, reads have to be broadcast. Okay, so if you say, is somebody selling furniture, you have to look at the first floor, second floor, and third floor to get all of the responses. Okay, because some messages are only posted on the first floor, some are only posted on the second floor. So this is in the partitioned bulletin board model. Reads are going to be broadcast. You have to send a read to all the shared distributed boards and get responses. But writes are local. If you want to post a message, you only go to the local one and post. Okay, so you can configure them in either of these two ways, where the board has a copy of everything. So the data is replicated. So reads are local, but the board has a subset. Your local board has a subset of the data. So then reads are broadcast and writes are local. Okay, Genie allows you to configure this in either of these two ways. Okay. So that's basically what I had to say about Genie. Okay, I'm going to take a 1 minute pause here to see if there are questions on middleware. I have three slides that I hadn't covered when we had done the World Wide Web lecture. I'm going to go back and talk about them a little bit. Okay, but any questions about this loose form of coordination? It's a very different way of writing applications. You send a message without knowing who the message is intended to. You don't have a recipient and just goes and hangs around on some bulletin board and you take the delivery.
So why not just use regular database?
Why not use a regular database? So this tuple space is like a database, right? But the thing is, because these systems are designed for auto discovery, okay, you want to be able to figure out where the database resides. So if you walk into some environment and you don't even know, so you have to know where the bulletin board is. to sort of the analogy. If you don't even know where the bulletin board is, you cannot figure that out. So what they have done is they have tried to basically, at the underneath, it is a very simple form of a database. A tuple space is a database without too much of the transactional baggage and all that. It has records, it has tuples, you can make queries with that match it and so on. Okay, so think of it as a lightweight database with only one caveat, where you can actually go and look for the database without knowing where it is to begin. Okay, because you need to find where the bulletin board is if you are in an unknown environment. Okay, this allows you to basically go broadcast and look for the bulletin board and then go and look for data. That's the way it is. Yes.
How does it deal with stale data? Like, say a printer comes in, it writes to the tuple space, and then unplugs the printer like some hours later.
So question is, how do you deal with stale data where a printer comes in, it announces itself, and then you switch it off? Is the data going to be the same? Right, so this is going to give you the libraries or the platform or the middleware to do it. Consistency is left to the application writer. Right? So when you write an application that uses a bulletin board, you have to deal with timeouts. How long should a message arrive? Should you remove the message after a while? All that is left to the application program. It is not going to do it automatically for you. You, the application programmer, have to figure out how to deal with exactly that issue. Okay. Any other questions here? Okay. So we are done with middleware. I'm just going to go back to these three slides that I skipped some time ago and come back to them. So we were this was the World Wide Web lecture where we were talking about caching, proxy-based caching. We said in the proxy caching architecture, rather than doing client-server, your client-proxy-server architecture. The proxy is a cache of web content, and you can go and, rather than sending your web browser talking to the server, browser talks to the proxy. The proxy has the web page, you just deliver it to the browser. If not, you have a cache miss, you go to the server and get it. Okay. And I said consistency can be addressed using push or pull. Okay. In the push-based model, the server will push any updates to the web page to the proxy. The pull-based model, the proxy has to go and pull. And I said push-based is stateful, and the server will have to keep state for a long time, but it is strong in provide stronger form of consistency. Pull-based, all the intelligence is at the proxy, but you can serve stale data because the proxy needs to keep checking with the server whether the data has changed or page has changed, and you have to go back and look at whether the data has changed. Okay, so there is a hybrid approach that uses a combination of push and pull. Okay, this is based on the notion of a lease. Okay, and the reason I wanted to go back and revisit this is because leases, although we'll talk about them for web caching, they are a more general concept. It's a very common distributed system mechanism. Okay, lease is essentially a contract for a fixed period of time. It's like your lease on an apartment. Okay, it's a contract for a fixed period of time, and that contract says if you pay rent, you get to stay there. Okay? This contract says if something happens, you will be notified. Okay, so a lease essentially is a contract for a fixed period of time. It says that the server agrees to do something for that period of time. In the context of caching, okay, let's say the proxy has cached a web page that's at the server. The proxy wants to ensure that the web page is consistent, which means if the owner of the web page updates it at the server, okay, the proxy wants to know it has been updated so it doesn't serve stale content to clients. Okay. So you can then take a lease on that web page saying, here, give me a 1 hour lease, and notify me if the object changes until the lease is active. So while the lease is active, the proxy is guaranteed that if somebody changes the web page at the server will notify it. At the end of the lease, basically you can either renew the lease or just let it lapse. If you let it lapse, the state is removed from the server. If you renew it, if you have interest in getting a more update, you renew it and the state is kept at the server. So the lease is a mechanism by which the server can limit the amount of time it has to keep state. In a pure push-based architecture, there was no expiration. Once the proxy cached the page, you are stuck. You have to keep sending notification whether the proxy is interested in the page or not. Here, you basically give a lease for a certain period, saying next 1 hour or 1 day or 1 week, you will be notified. At the end of it, the proxy can decide, is the page being accessed by anyone? If not, let the lease expire. There's no reason to keep it. If the the proxy thinks that it is still getting requests for the page, you renew the lease. Okay, so this is the picture here where the client makes a HTTP request to the proxy. First time you do this, you go get the, it's a cache miss here. So you go to the web server, download the HTML page or whatever it may be, and also you request a lease. Okay? So you get the page with the lease for a certain time. Okay? And while that lease is active, you are going to get invalidate or update request on the server. So you'll never have stale content in your cache. At the time the lease expires, you are going to basically throw it out. Okay? The reason this is a hybrid approach is that it matches the benefits of push and pull. The lease duration is zero. This is basically a polling based approach. It's a pure pull based approach. The lease duration is infinite. This becomes a pure push based approach. Yes, and if you are somewhere in between, you have push until the lease is expired. Once the lease expires, it basically becomes a pull for the next lease and the next version of the pay. So it's a nice hybrid scheme whereby the server can control the duration of the lease and decide how long do you want to keep the state, how many proxies are out there, and so on. So it's so this notion of a lease, as I said, although we are looking at it for web caching, it's a contract. So any system where you need to do something for a certain amount of time, you can use the notion of a lease to do that. And you can attach a time duration to the lease, say, I'm going to do something, but only for this much time. And that's a lease or a contract. At the end of that lease expiration, we have to decide whether to continue the contract or let it lapse. Okay? So a mechanism that's actually used in distributed systems for other things as well. So there's been work done on how do you decide how long a lease to give for a page. Okay? So for instance, you could say, I'm going to decide it based on the popularity of the object. Okay? CNN may say, my home page, I'm going to give longer leases because it's very popular. Okay, but some page buried deep in the CNN side, why give like a 1 week lease when it's infrequently accessed? So the server can decide. If pages are popular, give longer leases because very likely that the proxy will have renewed interest. Okay, so you can decide whether it's popularity based, whether it's age based. Okay, give longer leases to objects that haven't changed for a while because the server is sure it won't have to do much work, or vice versa. Or you can even do it based on the load or the amount of state. If the load is high, give shorter leases because the lease will expire quickly and you don't have to do any more work in sending notifications. So you can vary the lease duration based on a variety of system metrics. What metric you pick is not quite important here. Just to give you a flavor of the server gets to tweak the duration, okay, based on many different metrics or what it is trying to accomplish. But while the lease is active, this proxy knows that it's actually going to get all of the valid invalidates and so on. Yeah, so it's a useful scheme to use for a variety of different scenarios. Okay. The second concept that we had skipped over was this notion of cooperative caching. Okay, so what cooperative caching does is it allows different proxy servers or different proxies to cooperate or coordinate with each other to service a request. Yeah, so here is basically an example of, here are some clients, okay, that's a web server, okay, here are some caches. Okay. Assumption is each client talks to its local cache, okay, to figure out, or whenever it needs to make an HTTP request, it is going to send it to the cache. If the cache has the content, it will basically send back the page immediately. The question is, what happens if the cache does not have the web page you're requesting? So in the normal case, if you have a cache miss, you essentially go to the server and get the web page. In cooperative caching, you are going to first ask your nearby cacher saying, do you have this page? If a nearby cache actually has the page, even though you don't, you fetch it from that cache rather than going to the server. So this is a form of cooperation between proxies. It allows proxies, so it makes the cache at this proxy looks like a logical unified cache of all the content cached across its peers. So the cache is actually becomes larger, so the hit rate goes up. Right? Less burden on the server if you can get the content from someone else rather than having to come to the server. It is often used in content distribution networks where there are lots of proxies. Even if one proxy doesn't have it, another proxy in the system may have the content and give that to you. So you don't have to go to the server. Okay, so here's just sort of the series of steps. So you basically ask for a web page, okay, and if you don't have it, you are going to send messages to your peers, okay, as well as a parent. In this case, it assumed that the proxies are arranged in a hierarchy, saying, do you have this page? Okay, these messages are labeled ICP, that's for Internet Cache Protocol. What that, you don't need to worry about what that is. All that you are saying is, do you have this web page that this client has requested? Okay. And they will all reply saying yes or no. Okay, and if it's a yes, then you will basically, so you will get it from one of the caches. If it is a no, then you will basically send it to the parent saying, go get this page for me. Okay. This is a multi-level hierarchy. This is going to recursively repeat. The parent will then send that to its siblings and its parent until it goes all the way to the root. And if there is a global miss, nobody in this hierarchy has it, you will actually go and get an HTTP from the server and it will trickle down. Okay? So basically it will come down and then you will get the content. Right. So this is how sort of these proxies can coordinate to get a web page for you. Okay. Now I'll only say one thing, which is that in this case, although you are cooperating, you will see the number of message exchanges that have gone on just to get one web page. Okay. Typically, your client would have sent one HTTP request and gotten a response. Here we saw about a dozen messages go back and forth. What that means is user is sitting and waiting, saying, I went to the CNN page, still not loading. Seconds and seconds go by and you don't actually get the page. So that reduces user satisfaction. Okay. So what you want is, if you don't have the page, you want to quickly figure out if it's there somewhere or get it from the server and not sit and send all these messages back and forth. Okay, that is what is shown on the last slide, which I'm going to just talk in a few seconds and then stop. So here you don't have this big hierarchy which causes the request to trickle up. Rather, you just keep a table which says, what do I have and what do my neighbors have? Okay. When a request comes in, you can immediately check, do I have the web page? If yes, you return it to the browser. And if no, you look at the table saying, do my neighbors have it? If so, you basically go and get it from the neighbors and you are done at that point. Okay. So it's a much simpler scheme where you use a table or a directory to quickly figure out and not exchange too many messages. Still cooperation, but you can quickly make decisions and not spend a lot of time trying to figure out where the pages are. Okay. So with that, I'm going to stop the discussion. I just wanted to say a little bit about cooperative caching and leases. Content that we have skipped over. So we are actually done. Okay, so just quickly show this and stop. So we have basically covered all of the topics we wanted to cover. We are sort of done with the class. Okay, so as I mentioned, final exam is on Friday. I already put up a sample final on the course webpage. Okay, you will have it at 9 a.m. on Friday. It will be due the following day. Okay, you'll have to turn it in over Moodle. I'm here this week. If you have any, as you review the material, if you have any questions, come by, talk to me. I have office hours. You can also drop by at other times. So I'm happy to talk to you. And you still have your lab 3 due. I think many of you probably will turn it in later, is my guess, rather than earlier. That's okay. If you have any questions about the lab, again, either the TA or I are here, you can come talk to us. Okay. So only one last thing to be done is the course evaluation. I need a volunteer to administer this. Okay. So you can then find it. Anybody wants to do this? All right. You know how to do it, right? You have to put the schedule number and so on.